Let's get to the Jersey Central Newsmaker Hotline, our weekly get-together with our good friend Barry Blank from National Estate Jewelry Buyers in East Brunswick. Barry, good morning to you. And before we get to our topic here, I just wanted to discuss about this fire yesterday. This is at the Notre Dame Cathedral there in Paris. And when you're talking about things that are centuries old, I mean, it's just some of the artifacts alone that are in this building. And I think about just some of the stained glass that lost forever as a result of this fire here. These are simply things that there's no dollar amount you could ever put on things like this, is there?
No, there is no dollar amount.
No chance you could, right?
You know what? On something like this, the Notre Dame in France was built in the 12th or 13th century.
Yeah.
So even rebuilt, it's not going to be the same.
Yeah.
You know, it's hard to believe. Have you been to Europe?
It's been decades, literally decades.
Well, yeah. One thing, and I don't remember the book, but it was about the church builders. And one of the sought-after positions was the head of the church building department, whatever it was called, I don't remember, construction department.
Mm-hmm.
Because this person would have a lifetime position, which would probably be passed to his heirs. And they were in charge, and because it didn't take 1, 2, or 10 years to build one of these, and if you've seen them, they're majestic, they're beautiful. It took lifetimes with a capital, with an S at the end, not a capital S, but an S. So the person who started it would produce the plans, would produce the, and then they would have to hire the stone quarry people and this and that and the other thing. So these things were done over lifetimes.
Yeah, and it's pretty remarkable that if someone who was designing a church like this or was involved in the construction, it'd be like, this is going to be a beautiful building. Too bad it's going to take so long to build that I won't live to see its completion. But I guess you still, you use your craft and your skill just to make it as magnificent as possible. And to think that it's gone forever is really just kind of heartbreaking. Sure.
Without electricity, without engines, without anything, the stones were cut by man. By hand cut without any mechanization is unbelievable. The Gaudi Church in Barcelona is one of the most beautiful churches in the world, and you wouldn't think that it was designed such a long time ago.
Yeah,
places you just have to visit.
Yeah, just remarkable architecture. Unfortunately, a lot of it is lost forever, which is really sad. Our topic today, Barry, we're going to talk about amber and what exactly amber is and where it comes from. This is a complete education for me because I know absolutely zero about what amber even is. So I'm all ears, and I want to learn something from you today about this.
I'm going to tell you, most people think anything that looks amber colored, which is a butterscotch-like color, is amber. And the bottom of the line is it's not. Amber comes from the fossilized resin from northern European pine trees, very specifically. It does appear in many, many places. What happens, I don't know, you ever park your car under a pine tree?
I have, yes.
And you come back and there's little droplets of this thicky, Real thick substance on your windshield?
Yes, and then I ask myself, why did I park underneath a pine tree, right?
Yeah. Well, this is a very simplistic way of, if you think, because amber is not sticky in the fossilized form. It as these pine trees decay, and there must have been major pine forests, the resin solidifies into huge reservoirs, and then it begins to gel and harden. At what point it becomes amber, I don't know, but it could look like plastic, but it has a really different feel. Sometimes it comes in pebbles or rock-looking things, and then it's fashioned into other things. But amber is a resin. It's a natural resin, and there are many ways to tell the difference between amber and plastic, some of which are destructive. Or could be destructive. The first thing you have to do is look at it. And you got to look to see what does it feel like? People, well, if it says it has an insect in it, it's real. That's not true, because a lot of people make resins today and put insects in it just to make people think it's real.
Yeah, that sounds like something you could easily recreate as something fake, sure.
Totally. But if you find an insect, that's what Jurassic Park was based upon, taking
right.
the DNA from an insect in a fossilized piece of amber. I think a little contrived, but but who knows?
That's Hollywood, right.
That's Hollywood. They have poetic license. Or as Mel Brooks would say, onomatopoetica. I can just hear him saying that. So you look at it, if it looks like a slaggy piece of glass, like it's twisting and turning, it's probably glass or plastic. It should be warm to touch. It's never cold. Because, again, it's like a resiny material, like, you know, a resin.
Do you see a lot at your store? Does a lot show up through the door at your store there, Barry?
You know, we see a fair amount of amber, and it can be very, very valuable. We sold a strand of necklace, a strand of butterscotch amber beads for over $1,000 recently. So
wow.
It could be really valuable. And it needs an expert to know which is better and which isn't. But, it's important.
Yeah, bring it in and have you or someone on your staff there take a look at it and see if it's authentic, right?
That's 100% true. So, we work very hard at it. We also use something, the destructive test. One is called a hot point, where you take a needle, put in a pair of pliers, and heat it up till it's white hot.
Mm-hmm.
And you gently touch the stone to be tested. If it smells like plastic, it's probably plastic. If it smells like resin or something not quite cold, but something natural, it could be amber.
Mm.
The other thing, if you supersaturate a solution of salt into water, amber usually floats and plastic usually sinks. These are things that are indications only, and sometimes, and most of the time, it takes an expert to know for sure.
Gotcha. So if you think you have some, bring it on over to your place, and why not bring it today? And there's free evaluations that happen on Tuesday. So stop by.
Tuesday,
yeah,
right?
Every Tuesday. National Estate Jewelry Buyers, Route 18 North in East Brunswick, right next to FedEx there on 18 in East Brunswick. Do stop by and say hello to Barry. House calls, Barry, you're doing those? Are they starting to ramp up a little bit?
I got to tell you, I love to do house calls because, you know, there are people who can't get out. There are people who have collections that are so huge of coins and jewelry that they need them. They need me to come or meet them at the bank vault. I'm happy to do any of them.
That's awesome. All right, so stop in on Tuesday. The free evaluation days are happening. National Estate Jewelry Buyers, Route 18 in East Brunswick. Barry, as always, thank you for the time today, and we'll talk again next week, all right?
My pleasure.